Next question.
Okay. You have take on rituals.
Yes.
Because all along you have never promoted any ritual, never taught any rituals.
Right.
And suddenly we post these photographs where you are offering puja to your guru or to some deity or doing Navratri in full flare or arranging for Shivratri. So it's quite a, like, you know, it shows the opposite. So
Yes, yes. I'm glad somebody had asked this question to me. That's why it came up for discussion. There's a section of spiritual seekers that believes all rituals are superfluous, unnecessary, and should not be indulged. And there's a certain section of sadhaks who love to indulge in rituals all the time. And there's a good lot in between. For a long time, and in my early part of my, you can say, journey, spiritual journey, I was one of those who believed that rituals are completely unnecessary. But thanks to my guru, Babaji, I came to learn that that is not the case. Now I'll tell you why I thought that rituals are an absolute waste of time and completely unnecessary. Because you see, I used to read a lot of spiritual literature and philosophy. And a lot of that philosophy was Advaita philosophy. Now, Advaita philosophy is a philosophy of oneness. There's only one and nothing else. Just God. And nothing else exists. Now it's a very attractive philosophy to read and to think about and mull on. When you're sitting in a nice air-conditioned room with a full stomach, it's fine. But the moment you have one pain in the back or in your leg or in your head, and your stomach starts craving for food, the Advaita goes out of the window. You know? But, you know, when at a certain stage in your life, you are an armchair philosopher. So at the stage of an armchair philosopher, you feel that, oh, this is just perfect, I am firm in my belief. Again, it's somebody else's words, somebody else's experience, not your own. Yes, there are great sages who have practiced Advaita. But there are only a handful. And only a handful can succeed doing that. Armchair spiritualists cannot be Advaita yogis. So, reading that and thinking that that is a great way to go, I used to have this believe that no, rituals are completely unnecessary, there is no need for that. Everything is within yourself and you know, you don't need to depend on anything outside. No, but that's not right. You see, there are certain rituals and those rituals are necessary if you are living on the planet in physical form. There are three types of rituals. Regardless of religion, regardless of the philosophy you follow, regardless of all that, there are three types of rituals. One is purificatory rituals, number one. Number two, celebratory rituals. And number three, placatory rituals. I'll just briefly explain to you. Purificatory rituals are those rituals required for the purification of you physically, mentally, and energetically. Before you can embark on doing a lot of things on this path, certain rituals are to be performed to bring about a level of purity in the mind, in the body, and in your energy. Now, the level of these rituals and the frequency of rituals reduces as humans evolve, one personally and two as a planet. So now we have come to a stage where long unwinding purificatory rituals which were necessary many years back are not necessary. They have become superfluous. Yes, I agree with that. Though some may still be relevant and necessary to bring about that, maybe just that shade of purification which otherwise cannot come through any other means. The second type of rituals is celebratory rituals. Sometimes we need to celebrate certain things. Now you can't celebrate sitting like this and say, okay, I'm celebrating, but I'm not going to say a word. I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to sit and stare out into space. That's not a celebration. There is a ritual, there is a process by which you need to celebrate certain things, and they are in the order of the universe to celebrate. Sometimes they are connected with certain energies, sometimes they are connected with certain entities, sometimes they are connected with certain seasons. Mostly they are connected with elements which sustain us. Yes, certain rituals may be necessary. You can't say I'll dispense with all of them. It doesn't mean you have to indulge in rituals all the time and spend your entire life doing rituals. No. But sometimes certain rituals do become mandatory. Then the third type of rituals are placatory rituals. What does it mean by placatory rituals? You do those rituals to please somebody, to placate somebody. Somebody could be a human being, it could be an entity, it could be an energy, it could be an avatar, it could be a form of God, it could be one of the gods or the goddesses. That need to be placated, that need to be pleased, because you maybe want something, you may want to just express your gratitude, you may want to express your devotion. How do you do all this without some kind of a ritual? So certain rituals become necessary either because they are purificatory in nature, celebratory or placatory. And a lot of people think that no, we can dispense with them. We can, yes, you can. It's not that you cannot, but you may choose not to for certain reasons. If I want to celebrate the existence of a goddess or a god or a, yes, I'll have a celebratory ritual. If I want to show gratitude to my guru, I will do his aarti or I will do his puja. So it is not that rituals are a thing of the past and they do not fit into our world. No. Depends on what you do, what kind of ritual you do, and for what purpose. That is important. Now again, blindly following rituals without knowing what you're doing and why you're doing it, that is dumb. That's a waste of time and energy and resources. But doesn't mean that all rituals are nonsense and should never be done. No, that is a complete misrepresentation. If you are going to use your own mind, if you are going to use your own instincts, why go to a guru? Why make a guru? Fend for yourself.
This ego is a big problem. All the time there is judgment, and since guru is in high life, every single action can be judged and put it into perspective according to our own level or understanding,
but
maturity.
But gurus and saints and sages, spiritual masters, they have only one agenda, and it is a universal agenda. They do not serve personal agenda. They never do. Or they have no right to be there. Then you are a con man. Then you are fooling me. You are serving a personal agenda, then that's it's over. It doesn't come.
So easily.
Because your mind plays games. And faith is a round bottom vessel. Keeps tilting. Keeps tilting. Never not straight. Keeps tilting this way, this way. You hear somebody from this way, it tilts this way. You hear another thing, it tilts this way.
Not only that, Guruji. Suppose you have said something and it doesn't happen like that. We just hold you, hadn't happened, then meaning we're finished. There is no reason to keep faith. This, I think, this quote will remember for a long time. We have to make that faith into a square bottom and surrender. And
yes.
Just trust that you will take care of us.
See, if with your heart you accept a guru, then that round bottom must become square. If it doesn't, then you have to work on yourself first, on your purification. The guru doesn't have to work on it. You have to work on your purification. And many times that faith is tested at all levels. When I started my tapas second time, my faith was tested to the ultimate level. I've told this story before. It was tested with the ultimate extent. You have to pass the test. There's no escaping that. And that is why many great sages and saints and gurus, they wait a long, long time before they give the real spiritual secrets, the real powers to a disciple. They wait a long time because they know that the faith is still a round bottom. only when they see that it becomes a square, solid body, then they give the real stuff. Till then they don't.